Thank you all so much for being here and for your commitment to moving forward the Democratic Party. Chairman Perez and Senator Sanders chose to start their nationwide tour here in Maine for good reason. Yes. They know that issues such as economic opportunity and fairness, college affordability, and the impact of high healthcare costs are felt deeply by the people of Maine. The Maine Democratic Party is firmly committed to listening to our supporters and building our state party up from the grassroots. I couldn't be happier that Senator Sanders and Chairman Perez are here encouraging Mainers to come together and fight, because when progressives fight and stand together for a better future, we win every time. And we are not just Democrats. We are not just Maine Democrats. We balance love for our heritage with a desire for innovation. Our hands are guided by compassion and common sense as we work to move Maine forward together. I would like to take a moment to recognize the folks who are moved to do this important work in their communities. Would all of the elected members of the legislature, as well as municipal and county officials, please stand up and wave your hand? Thank you for your work in putting democratic values into action in your communities. Maine has a strong tradition of engaged progressive leaders, and with your help, we will elect more of them this year and next year and every year thereafter. So once again, welcome to the state of Maine. Welcome to the kickoff of this rally. And with that, I'd like to introduce our next speaker, a nurse, a local activist, a graduate of Emerge Maine, and the future of politics, Samantha Parody.
Growing up in the St. John Valley of Arista County, I knew the value of community early on. From potato harvest to moose hunting to fiddlehead picking, we come together in northern Maine. A deep connection to where I come from and those who have come before me led me here today. As a registered nurse, I have the privilege of caring for people of all ages in their time of greatest need. I have seen firsthand the difference the Affordable Care Act has made. Lobstermen, students, small business owners, and farmers have access to health insurance, access to primary care, and access to emergent care in the face of an acute illness. I am a Democrat because access to health care is a right that should be afforded to all. Yeah. I should not be seeing patients in a diabetic coma who ran out of insulin 2 weeks ago because they could not afford their $400 copay. I should not have to discharge an older man home to live in his camper without heat or without running water, knowing that he will not be able to care for his wound at home. These stories have led me to take action through advocacy. This past year, I participated in Emerge Maine. Yeah. It's a training program that teaches Democratic women to run for office and win. This fall, I plan to run for office. Our most vulnerable community members need you too. We need you to support the candidate running in Jackman. We need you to run campaigns in Holton, and we need you to run for office in Lubeck. We, as Democrats, need to come together and fight back. I would like to introduce Claire Cummings of the Maine Young Democrats.
Hi, everyone. So, regardless of why you showed up today, you showed up for a reason. Something compelled you to find the space and time to be here, and I want you to ask yourself what that reason is. Right? Maybe it's because you love a certain senator from Vermont. About the new DNC chairman and the future of the Democratic policy. Or maybe you aren't even sure why you're here, but you knew this was where you needed to be. For me, I showed up today because I believe in progress. I believe in the importance of change and in our collective capacity to make change. I believe that together, we can create a future that works for all of us. But to do so, we need to make change. Without change, there is no growth, and without growth, there is no progress. Revolutionary activist Dr. Angela Davis once said, "I'm no longer accepting the things I can't change. I'm changing the things I can't accept." Each and every one of you has the power to change the things you can't accept. It may seem daunting or even impossible at times, but I want to assure you that change is always an option. Change is always possible. For me, I was unwilling to accept the lack of young voices in Democratic politics. So I stepped out of my comfort zone, and I ran for, and ultimately was elected to, leadership positions within the Maine Democratic Party and Maine Young Democrats. And I did this because I'm determined to make change by including more young voices in shaping Maine's future. It's actions like this, when each of us uses our individual and collective power to make change, that we're able to shape the progressive movement. Take ownership of your future and act on it. Progress and grow and move forward together. Now, like any good organizer, I'm going to end this with an ask, and it's a simple one. I'm asking you all to keep showing up. Show up to rallies like this one. Show up to school board meetings, to city council sessions, and to legislative hearings. Show up on the ballot. No matter how you do it, show up and make change. Make your voice heard and change the things you can't accept. So can I count on you to keep showing up?
Please welcome DNC Vice Chair, Assemblyman Michael Blake.
What's going on, Maine? Come on, come on. What's going on, Maine? Are we excited to have a good time tonight?
My name is Michael Blake. I'm an assemblyman in New York, but I have the honor of being one of your vice chairs for the Democratic National Committee. Thank you for your support. We are here first to say thank you. Thank you for believing in us. Thank you for believing in something bigger than all of us. This is about us saying that we're standing up for our communities. We're standing up for our country. We reject the nonsense and the noise that's happening in D.C. We're going to build something stronger, something better that's happening in our communities on today. We are united. We are members of a party that says we stand up for inclusion and progress. We fight and say we are the party that will say we fight for workers' rights and workers' values. We are the party that says you will not disrespect women in the ways that you're doing that right now. We are the party that says that we will not allow you to have your unconstitutional bans that try to divide us. We are not going to allow that to be the case. We will stand up. We are the Democratic Party. That is who we are. We are here to send a message. This is not about them trying to take their country back. No, no, this is about us uniting our country. This is about us saying that we come together to fight back. Fight back against injustice. Fight back against the noise. Fight back against those that are trying to divide us. Trump is approaching 100 days, but we need to make sure that he only has one term. He has to be done by the end of his first term. But it's about us making sure that we cannot just be a party that's focused on the White House. No, we have to be focused on the school board. We gotta be focused on the State House. We gotta be focused on what's going on in Congress. We gotta be focused in all aspects that are happening right now. And here in Maine, we don't wanna just win elections, not just this year, but we gotta make sure you get a new governor next year right now. So we come here tonight following the great leadership of our DNC chairman, Tom Perez, that is uniting us and mobilizing us. And we're sending a message to all everyone across the country. We're starting this tour with this guy. You might have heard of him. His name is Bernie Sanders. So it's about us saying we're going to fight to make sure that people have better wages. We're gonna fight to make sure that equal pay for equal work finally becomes the law of the land. We're gonna fight to make sure that we're standing up for everyone, because you might have lost an opportunity, but you're not gonna lose a chance with this party. So we are here with a call to action. Join us. Join your local county parties. Join with the state party. Join us with a movement right now, because we cannot continue to go backwards. It's about us moving forwards. Forward to fight for something better. Forward for fighting something stronger. Forward for fighting for a Democratic Party. That is who we are. And we cannot be united in just occasional times. We have to be united together all of the time. This is our time. This is our moment. Let's go do this. Maine, come together and fight back. Thank you, everybody.
Please welcome DNC member and Maine State Senate Democratic leader, Troy Jackson.
Good evening, Maine Democrats. So my name's Troy Jackson. I'm the Democratic leader in the Maine Senate, and it's truly an honor to be here with you today. So I'm from Allegash, and that's 6 hours north of here, near the Canadian border. It's a stone's throw away from some of the most remote forests in North America, where generations of my family served as loggers. Where I'm from, people live their lives far removed from the powerful elites that seem to hold their destinies in their hands. Back home, I never saw a big pharma or insurance company lobbyist, but I saw the prices of prescription drugs skyrocket so that my neighbors and my family couldn't afford to stay healthy. And I saw insurance companies with their insurance so complex and expensive that people stayed sick because they couldn't get the medical care they deserved. When I was working in the woods, I never met a Wall Street executive or a hedge funds manager, but I did see hardworking people watch helplessly as their retirements disappeared and their homes were foreclosed upon. And I wasn't in the room when forces conspired to saddle my family and millions of other families like mine with the unbearable weight of student debt, a load that is holding back an entire generation of Mainers and Americans who should be off building a better future for themselves and for their kids. But 15 years ago, I had a little dream also. I thought if I could make it to Augusta, I could make the changes that families and communities like mine needed. I could fight for better wages and more affordable education and health care. And you know, in 2014, I became a Senate Democratic leader. But even then, the levers of power were out of reach more often than not. The entrenched power structures that had controlled my destiny and yours for far too long, they just weren't going to give up that easily. And since the last election, I've heard a lot of pundits talk about how the average American feels powerless. They said everyday folks felt like the system was rigged. But brothers and sisters, we don't feel like it's rigged. We know it's rigged. In the wake of last year's election, there's been a growing energy from like nothing I've ever seen before, and tonight's a perfect example of it. With each passing day, I hear more and more of you tell me that you're not only ready to fight for yourselves, you expect your political leaders to fight for you too. Not offer up your life in the name of bipartisanship or political deal-making. You know, the past is the past, and there's no denying it. But we are fixated on the future. We're here today to build a better Democratic Party in every state, every county, and every community. One that follows the energy and lead of the grassroots activists fighting on the ground every day. Only then will we finally be able to lift up working class people like you and me so that they can finally take on these entrenched power structures that are holding us all back. So I'm 48 years old. It's been a long time coming. I haven't felt like anyone really cared, like I had any place in this world. But ladies and gentlemen, there's a new sheriff in town. But it's not me, and it's not Tom Perez, and it's not even Bernie Sanders. It's all of you. You see, because justice and equality are not achieved by any one man or any one woman. It's going to take all of us standing together to demand a better world and do the work necessary to win it. It's going to take a movement of people joined together for living wages and equal pay. Join together for free college and universal health care. Join together for racial justice. And join together to combat climate change. And finally, join together to finally seize those levers of power that families here on the ground who have been ignored for far too long finally have a grasp. Together, we can topple these entrenched power structures, we can take control of our own destinies, and build the world that we all deserve. All of you are now firmly in control of this movement and this party. No matter what the actions of yesterday's power structures, today, you are the conductors of the new symphony of the Democratic Party. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Please welcome Congresswoman Shelley Pingree.
Thank you. Thank you, Troy, for the work you and the Senate colleagues and Speaker Gideon and her House colleagues do to fight against our governor's right-wing agenda. And thank you to Bernie for coming back to the state of Maine. I think you might know, we love you in Maine, Bernie, and we love you in the United States Senate. Thank you to our new chair, Tom Perez. We're excited you and Bernie decided to start right here in the great state of Maine. You got a lot of work cut out for you, and we're glad you're willing to do it. And to Phil, our party chair, thanks for your leadership, and Samantha and Claire, thank you so much for your heartfelt stories. You know, Samantha and I rode on the same ferry this morning to get here. Now, that only happens in Maine. I'm very proud to be a progressive voice representing Maine. We need to work hard and fight harder than ever. Since the election last November, people are rattled. Frankly, they're worried more every day. They call my office, they ask me on the street and at meetings, what can we do to fight back? Last week, somebody asked me, what keeps you up at night? Well, I can't sugarcoat it to any of you. Sleeping can be a little tough when there is so much to worry about. So humor me here. I'm going to tell you what I'm worried about. I'm worried about a president who's been dropping bombs and making threats on Twitter, but so far has not come to the Congress with a diplomatic strategy or a long-term plan. And he doesn't seem to remember that the United States Constitution requires him to ask Congress for an authorization for the use of military force before he proceeds any further. Never gonna get through this if you keep clapping. I wake up worrying that the most powerful leader of the world proudly said he dropped a bomb in reaction to the sight of innocent people, including women, small children, and even beautiful babies. Yet this same man, only weeks before, signed a travel ban preventing those families and their babies from seeking safety in our country. He wants $40 billion of your money to build a wall, not to unite us, but to divide us. I'm worried that every morning there will be a new Twitter post. Maybe he tells us he bombed a foreign country, or he insults a member of Congress, or he has to remind us once again that he won the Electoral College. Get over it. And with each new Twitter post, I worry whether he is just trying to take us off track of his low approval ratings, or maybe he's trying to distract us from the latest information about the Russian government's interference in our elections. I think he's just hoping we'll ignore all the new information coming about the Russia financial dealings, perhaps with his family, or the foreign agents associated with his campaign. And of course, he's constantly reminding us that there's no need to look at his tax returns. He tells us there's nothing there of interest. Seriously? Does he think we were born yesterday? Or, as we say in Maine, that we just fell off the turnip truck? So I'm worried that we have a president that shows so little respect for the fundamentals of government that virtually each one of the secretaries in his cabinet have been appointed not because they believe in the mission of the organization they're supposed to lead, but in fact they've been appointed to dismantle it. I think you know who I'm talking about. How about a secretary of education that doesn't believe in public education? How about a secretary of health and human services who led the charge to repeal the ACA while he served with me in the House, reduce Medicaid funding to the states, and no doubt he has plans to privatize Medicare? How about Scott Pruitt, the administrator of... Exactly! For the past 6 years, he's been suing the EPA for its efforts to regulate mercury, smog, and other forms of pollution. And I stay awake at night thinking about the actions of a president who has told us the concept of global warming was created by and for the Chinese. Okay, we know different. This is Maine, and climate change is serious. We live in a state where the sea level is rising, the water's becoming more acidic, and it is warming at a rate 99.9% faster than the rest of the world. This is Maine. Our fishermen are worried about that climate change and the warming oceans. They're worried that the lobsters and other species may move to northern waters. It'll bring new diseases or destroy our economy and the culture of so many coastal communities. And everything else. We don't know when that day will arrive, when we can no longer fix the problem or turn back. But I lay awake and worry, what will I say when my grandchildren and their children ask, who was minding the store when we allowed the destruction of our planet to go forward? But I'm pretty sure I'm talking to a crowd who knows how much we have to worry about these issues and so many more. I am very proud to be representing you and proud to be speaking up and fighting back every day. But we... Thank you. But I think you know, we are all in this together. And it was your calls, your emails, and you organizing and showing up at rallies and marches in numbers like people have never seen before that let the president and my Republican colleagues know that people are watching. How about that Obamacare vote? On the afternoon of March 24th, the Republicans had kept the House in session for an extra day. We were waiting around because they kept telling us they were very close. They almost had the votes. Now, this is the same Republican Party who for 7 years have been forcing us to vote to repeal the ACA more than 60 times. But all that time, they had never developed a new plan. They just dumped a bunch of bad ideas together. Ideas like ways to give insurance company more money. Make it easier to get health care if you were wealthy, but not if you were old or you were sick or you were poor. And they thought they could sneak it by the American public. But as you know, phones rang off the hooks. People attended town halls in record numbers across this country and weren't afraid to say, this plan is no good. Finally, on that Friday in DC, the Republican leaders had to tell us to go home. There'll be no vote. The people won. I was very proud to be a Democrat that day, but I was even more proud to to live in a democracy that was working in the way it was meant to, where the citizens said, "You can't fool us with your lies and your distractions." But we can't back down. We can't let any of this become normal in the United States of America. We have to take back our country so we can get beyond fighting just to keep our democracy from slipping away and start fighting for a positive, progressive agenda that gives opportunity to anyone and everyone in our country, not just a very few at the top. I know you know what that means. That means fighting for an agenda that is all about turning our healthcare system into a single-payer healthcare plan. Fighting for women's reproductive health. Fighting for free education. Fighting for a country where we keep toxic chemicals out of our food and our environment. And where we support renewable energies for the jobs and the health of our environment. We need to be fighting for an end to Citizens United. We have to stop allowing corporations to be treated like people. Put an end to our corrupt system of financing campaigns and so much more. But to get there, we gotta stay in this together. We need to win the political debates that go on every day in Augusta and in Washington, D.C. We need to win back the Blaine House. We gotta win the Maine Senate. And we have to bring Democratic control of the United States House and Senate to slow down this president's agenda before he gets too far. This is all about the health, the safety, the security of everyone in this country and the future ahead of us. To win, we have to do this together. I'm proud to stand with you every day and every one of you to make sure we make that happen. Thank you very much.
Please welcome Democratic National Committee Chairman, Tom Perez.
Hello, Maine. Good evening. What an honor to be here. Tough act to follow. Let's give it up for your wonderful Congresswoman, Shelley Pingree. Thank you, Shelley. And let's give it up in advance for our next speaker, Bernie Sanders. I am so excited, folks. I am so excited to be on this tour with Senator Sanders. We're going all across the country to talk about our values, to talk about our unity, to talk about the road ahead. And I'll tell you, folks, we got a lot of work to do, folks. There's no doubt about it. But we have been getting a lot of work done thanks to you in this audience. You are the movement. You are indeed the movement. And that is why I'm so excited to be here. Now, I got asked a number of times, why did you choose Maine as your first stop? And you know what, folks? Here's one of the reasons. We wanted to choose a state where all of the movement members had experience working with a bully. And with your governor, you got a heck of a lot of experience working with a bully. So you can teach us. We need to turn the page on LePage, I'll tell you, my friends. And we need to turn LePage soon. Of all the mean-spirited things I've seen governors do and presidents, in my top five list, in addition to his refusal to expand Medicaid, which the voters will correct in the next election, I'm confident of that. in my top five list will always be his refusal to arm the police with the life-saving tool of Narcan. Anybody the opioid epidemic does not discriminate. It's in every zip code. It's touched communities everywhere. It's touched people very, very near and dear to me. And when you have a governor who says that Narcan doesn't save lives, it postpones death, that's unconscionable. And thank you, Janet Mills, for stepping up to the plate as your attorney general. Thank you for what you're doing, Attorney General. That's why I love coming to Maine. Because you've got so many progressive leaders here. And you know what, folks? You're going to have more progressive leaders because next year you will have a Democrat in District 2 to help Shelley in Washington. I have no doubt about it. And you'll have a Democrat, a progressive in your governorship in Augusta. That's what we will do. And we'll fight like hell with you because the mission of the new DNC is not simply to elect the President of the United States. It is to elect Democrats from the school board to the Senate. And you know what, folks? We're going to take over the state Senate here in Maine next year when we get one more vote. That's what we're going to do. You know, we're almost 100 days into this administration on some levels for me, and I'm sure for you, and most importantly for people who have felt the brunt. It seems like 100 years. Chaos and carnage. When I heard him talk about carnage day one, I thought, you sure as hell have no standing to talk about carnage, pal. Because you're causing carnage day in and day out, and we see it everywhere. Literally, hours into his administration, he made it harder for first-time homebuyers to buy a home by reversing executive action from the Obama administration. Days later, he set in motion efforts to make it harder to save for retirement. How many of y'all got a 401k or an IRA? If you do, he's making it harder for you to save. And by the way, if you don't, he's making it harder for you to get one because he's not giving you a fair wage. And so this is what we saw early on. This is what we see from this chaos and carnage president. We just saw the confirmation of a Supreme Court justice who wants to eviscerate collective bargaining. Collective bargaining is what brought us the middle class in America. Collective bargaining, when the labor movement succeeds, America succeeds. That's what I learned growing up in Buffalo, New York. And you've got a hell of a labor movement here in Maine. And this justice is poised to go after that. Because you know what, folks? His record demonstrates a consistent pattern of ruling for large corporations over ordinary people. That's what this president nominated. This president has targeted immigrants and torn apart families. Imagine if you were that person, that little boy or little girl who got dropped off at school in Los Angeles, only to see your parent, literally within your eyesight, stopped by ICE for deportation. That is not who we are as a nation, my friends. Our diversity is our greatest strength as a nation. It's something to embrace, not something to fear. That's what we see from this administration. And let me give you news off the presses. This is tonight's executive order. I kid you not. It is called Buy American, Hire American. It's an executive order that's to be released tonight, directing that people buy American and hire American. Well, maybe you could start with your own damn businesses. Because you know what, folks? You know, over 50 pallets I spent a little time on the West Coast ports. You know, a pallet is a big-ass piece of equipment that holds a lot of clothing. That's a term of art, big-ass piece of equipment. And you know what, folks? What this does, over 50 pallets just from Ivanka's businesses come from China and Singapore since about the first of the year. Those aren't by American. Those are made in China. Those are made in Singapore. The wall that he wants to build is going to have a garage door because all the products he makes in Mexico are going to have to drive through it. You know that? And I haven't seen this executive order, but I'm rather confident, my friends, that if you turn it over, you'll see the inscription "Made in China" on the back of the executive order. Because you know what, folks? He talks a mean game, but he doesn't walk the walk. He talked to the leader of China just recently. He could have talked about all the jobs that have been lost to the dumping of steel by the Chinese government. Tens of thousands of good middle-class jobs that were lost. Did he raise that? Hell no, he had a sock in his mouth. Mr. Negotiator, if he was on The Celebrity Apprentice, he would have been kicked off by now. This is the president who declared with vigor on the campaign trail, "On day one, I shall declare China a currency manipulator. That's what I shall do on day one." And you know what, folks? Last week, you know what he did last week? He told China, "You're not a currency manipulator, and we're not going to do it." So that's what he did, my friends. That's the first 100 days. And you know what, folks? I'll tell you something about the first 100 days. The most remarkable thing was not anything Donald Trump did. The most remarkable thing is what you all did across this country, here in Maine, and across America. Because you know what, folks? January 20th was an important day, but January 21st was far more important. Millions of Americans, led by women, came out and said, "Donald Trump, you do not stand for our values. Donald Trump, you did not win this election. You did not win the popular vote. And Donald Trump, we will continue to resist." And resist you have done. And the work on the Affordable Care Act is perhaps the best example, because you have seen the potential devastation of the Affordable Care Act repeal here in Maine. Think about it. Just a few weeks ago, they were writing the obituary for the Affordable Care Act. And you know why that obituary didn't get published? Because of you, everyone in this room, going to members of Congress, telling their stories. And I'll tell you, folks, some of those stories are tragic. Stories like Christina Emard, a 28-year-old decorated Army veteran from Lebanon, Maine, roughly an hour from here. She suffered from PTSD, and when she became addicted to opioids, she needed help, and she died from an overdose last September. She had sacrificed more for our country in her short life than Donald Trump ever will, any day, anyhow. And to think of it, my friends, to think of it, you know, Donald Trump and the Republicans want to do away with it. And here's what I don't understand about Donald Trump and the Affordable Care Act. You know what, folks? He wants to brand everything. You know, you can go to the store and find Trump steaks. You know, Trump steak knives, Trump ties, Trump suits, you know, the Trump hotel. But he didn't want the Affordable Care Act branded after him. I don't know what to call it. Trump Care, Ryan Care, I'll tell you what I'd call it. I don't care, because those Republican leaders and President Trump don't give a shit about the people they were trying to hurt. That's what I say. And you know what, folks? The energy that I have seen everywhere in this country, regardless of who you voted for in the election last year, Republicans, Democrats, independents, working families parties, coming together to say, you know what? The Affordable Care Act has been a lifesaver, not a job killer. We've seen it everywhere, and we won because of you. And we will win other battles because of you and because of people, courageous people, doing what John Lewis, one of my mentors from the Civil Rights Movement, said, causing good trouble. We need to continue to cause good trouble, my friends, because good trouble is what made America great. Good trouble is what indeed will always make America great. And that good trouble includes making sure we call out this budget. They call it a skinny budget. I call it a shitty budget. Because you know what, folks? This budget, I learned from my tenure in local government and my work elsewhere that budgets are moral documents. They reflect the values of a community. You look at this budget, zeroing out Meals on Wheels. Our strength as a nation lies, among other things, in our compassion as a nation. We are strong because we are compassionate. And by the way, folks, when you zero out Meals on Wheels, you know what happens to the remarkably destitute folks you're zeroing out? They either die or they go into an institution. And you know what? Institutions cost a lot more money. So this is stupid policy, my friends. Really stupid policy. And maybe, just maybe, if he just went to Mar-a-Lago half the time, we'll take that savings and fund all the Mainers who would lose their Meals on Wheels coverage. So why don't we do that? Let's send an email to the president suggesting that. And let's send another email to him telling him, you know what? You said you were gonna stand up for people on manufacturing, but look at your budget. I was so privileged at the Labor Department to work with people in Maine who had lost their jobs. They lost their jobs and they were in danger of losing their dignity. And I worked for Ted Kennedy, and I learned from growing up in Buffalo, New York, that you know what? Your job is not just your paycheck. Your job is your identity. And we worked with folks who had talent and who simply needed a level playing field and a hand up, not a hand out, a hand up. And when we provided that to folks, we were able to put them on the pathway to prosperity once again. But what does this president want to do in his budget? He wants to eliminate funding for the Manufacturing Extension Partnership, which has resulted in $7 million over the past year in savings for Maine companies, and it has retained roughly 1,000 jobs in this state alone. We need to educate folks about the legacy of Donald Trump 100 days in. We need to tell that story, my friends. And we need to do it. We need to do it in the same manner that we did with the Affordable Care Act. That is what we do. That is how we succeed. And that is what we're going to continue to do. We need to tell the story that higher education is a pillar of success. My parents taught me that education was the great equalizer. I was 12 when my dad died. I'm the youngest of five. He died literally working to help put his kids through college. And you know what? We need to make sure that we understand that in our parents' generation, a high school education was enough to punch your ticket to the middle class. But for today's jobs and tomorrow's jobs, we need more than a high school education. That's why I commend your state Senate leadership in introducing the opportunity agenda, which will give meaning to what Bernie Sanders and the Democratic Party and the Democratic platform are talking about, leveling the playing field. I know a little something about this because I was one of those beneficiaries. I was a Pell Grant kid, worked my way through college. If I didn't have that hand up, I never would have been able to get through. And all too many people need that same hand up. But this president, what did he do last week? He made it harder for people saving for higher education to do so. Why? To help his cronies on Wall Street. We need to take to the streets on behalf of people seeking affordable access to higher education. We need to do so with Bernie Sanders. We need to do so with your Senate leadership. We need to do so with the Democratic Party here in Maine, with Phil Bartlett and others. We need to do so with everybody in this room. Because you know what, folks? Budgets are indeed moral documents. And you know what, folks? When we lead with our values, that is when we succeed. And you know what, folks? Here, I'll tell you something. I learned this firsthand. People ask me a lot, Tom, what do you miss most about your old job? I miss helping people at scale, is my answer. I can go home and tell my 14-year-old, Dad, what'd you do this week? We helped 2 million home health workers, mostly women of color, get access to basic minimum wage and overtime protections by enacting rules. That's the definition of a good week. We helped 10 million workers who were working overtime get paid for overtime by raising the overtime threshold. Middle class jobs deserve a middle class wage. We worked hard to make sure that when you go to the workplace, whether you are in the construction business or the steel business or the mining business, that the air you breathe is not going to kill you. It took us 50 years to do that because of the intransigence of the industry, but we did that. And so, that's what I love most about my job. And the reason I ran for this job is because when we have strong state parties everywhere and we elect good progressive people from the school board to the Senate and we're helping you to enact programs like the Opportunity Agenda, good things happen to good people. That's what happens when you have strong parties. That's what happens when you have strong partnerships. And that is why I ran for this job. Now, I know we have a lot of work to do in the Democratic Party. We have to earn your trust. When we earn your trust by putting our values into action, folks. And I learned a little bit about earning trust from a guy named Ted Kennedy. Ted Kennedy was my mentor, and I had the privilege of a lifetime working for Ted Kennedy. He taught me what it was like to be a progressive. He taught me about the importance of making sure we help the common man and the common woman fight for fairness, fight for economic security. He taught me what my values were as a Democrat and what our values are moving forward. And it was the privilege of a lifetime. And I was at the Steelworkers Conference last week. And I've been making house calls because I want to hear honest feedback. And people said to me, you know what, Tom? I don't know what the Democratic Party stands for. And I accept that criticism. And I'm here to tell you what we stand for. We believe in a government and economy that works for everybody, not just the powerful special interests. We believe that America works best when it works for everyone. We believe that we must respect the dignity of every person. We believe that zip codes should never determine destiny and that every single person is gifted and talented. We believe that our diversity is one of our greatest sources of strength. It's something to embrace, not fear. Somos los Estados Unidos, no somos los Estados divididos. We believe that when unions succeed, America succeeds. We believe that when unions succeed, the middle class succeeds. We believe that health care is a right, it's not a privilege. We believe that nobody who works a full-time job should live in poverty in this country. We believe that when women succeed, America succeeds. We believe that our nation can and must be strong and compassionate. And you know what, folks? We believe, as Congresswoman Pingree said, that climate change is a real threat. It is not a hoax. And you know what? We believe that the facts matter, and the term alternative facts should be an oxymoron. Someone get that memo to the Trump folks, because they're not getting it, folks. And I had the privilege, as I said, of working for Ted Kennedy. And I remember vividly the story he told of Bobby Kennedy. Back in the 60s, he was at a rally with Cesar Chavez, organizing farm workers in California. And he said at that time, and it is so resonant today, they stood at a defining moment in history, a moment that he called the point of difficulty and danger that would determine our country's future. And he went on to say that when your children and grandchildren take their place in America, taking good jobs at good pay, when you look at them, when you look at all of them, you will tell them, I was there. I did this. I marched. That's what Bobby Kennedy said in the 60s. And that is what I say to you today. You are in the process of doing this. You are in the process of marching. And when we are united, we are strongest as a party, as a nation, as a resistance movement. So whether you are a Republican in this room, a Democrat, an independent, I am here to say thank you for being part of the resistance. Thank you for putting your values into action. Thank you for causing good trouble. Let's cause good trouble together, because the arc of the moral universe is long, but it indeed bends toward justice. But I will tell you this, my friends. It does not bend on its own. Let's bend it together. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
Please welcome Senator Bernie Sanders.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Let me thank all of you for coming out tonight. It's a fantastic turnout. And I've got one question. Are you ready for a political revolution? Well, you come to the right place. I want to thank Phil Bartlett and Michael Blake and Samantha Paradis and Claire Cummings and Troy Jackson and Shelley Pingree and Tom Perez for their great remarks. Now, as New Englanders, we are kind of a blunt people. So let me get to the point. And the point is that this country faces enormous problems. That's the truth. And those problems are economic, they are political, they are social, they are racial, they are environmental, among many other issues. And these are problems, the most serious of them, which by and large are not significantly discussed by the corporate mainstream media. And they are certainly not being dealt with in the United States Congress. We change this country when we have the courage to be honest, when we understand that the problems that we face are caused by human decisions and they can be resolved by other human decisions. The problems that we face are not inevitable. They are not God-given. If we stand up as a people, if we become involved in a way we have never been involved before, if we have the guts to take on some very powerful forces in this country, if we do not allow demagogues to divide us up by race, religion, gender, national origin, or sexual orientation, brothers and sisters, if we stand together, there is nothing that we cannot accomplish. As we transform this country and make it the country that you and I know we can become. And here is the truth. It's a painful truth, but it is a real truth. And that is that today in Maine, today in Vermont, and today all over this country, millions of people are hurting, and they are hurting very badly. That is the simple truth, but it is a truth that has been too long ignored, even by Democrats. All over this country, people are asking if there is anyone in Washington, anyone in the media, anyone in the establishment who understands what it is like to work two or three jobs, become exhausted, and not have time for your kids. All over this country, workers are asking themselves, does anybody in corporate America understand what it means when a worker works 20 or 30 years on a job and one day walks into the plant and hears that his or her job is going to China or Mexico, despite the fact that that corporation is profitable? And does anybody in Washington know what it feels in your heart to lose a decent paying job at the age of 50 and have to go to work at a job which pays half the wages flipping hamburgers? Does anybody know what it means to be 60 years of age, to have worked hard for 40 years, and as you approach retirement, find out that you have virtually nothing in the bank and you are scared to death about what faces you? Does Washington understand what it means to be 20 years of age, to have done well in school, to dream of going to college to make it into the middle class, but your families lack the money for a college education. Does anybody talk about the fact that in minority communities across this country, youth unemployment is 20 or 30%, and people are seeing their young men end up in jail, not in higher education? Does anybody realize that throughout rural communities in our country today, in many cases, hope is gone and despair is rampant? And communities all over this country are seeing middle-aged people dying at a rate we have never seen before. They're dying of despair, of drugs, of alcohol, of suicide, because they see no future for themselves or their kids. That is, and much more, an important reality in America. We cannot push that reality under the rug. We have got to have the guts to deal with it and take on the powerful people who are responsible for that crisis. And here is what I worry about a whole lot. And that is when ordinary people feel that no one cares about them, that their lives are irrelevant. That is when people by the millions lose faith in the process and the hope for a better future. And when that occurs, bad things happen. By the millions, people in the United States are giving up on our national institutions. They are giving up on political parties and the ugly 30-second TV ads which bombard them in never-ending campaigns. They are giving up on the mainstream corporate media which discusses everything in the world except what is most important to the working people of this country. And most frighteningly, millions of people today in this country are giving up on the whole idea of democracy. Last November, when Trump won, please do not forget that only 55% of voting age citizens cast ballots, 45% did not. That election was one of the lowest voter turnouts of any major country on earth, and it is the lowest in the presidential elections since 1996. Trump may have won the Electoral College, and Clinton may have won the popular vote, but the truth is that most people did not vote. That was the single largest factor. 45% of people did not vote. They refused to vote. Even worse, in the midterm elections of 2014, and we're coming up to midterm elections in 2018. In 2014, when the Republicans captured the US Senate, only 36% of eligible voters participated in that election. Almost 2 out of 3 Americans did not vote, and the overwhelming percentage of low-income and working-class people did not go to the ballot box. The turnout for a midterm election in 2014 was the lowest in 72 years and 5 points lower than the previous midterm election. And then you think about it, the turnouts in local election for mayor, city council, school board, turnouts for primaries are even lower than that. Our job, it seems to me, is not complicated. Our job is to revitalize American democracy. Our job is to bring millions of people into the political process who today do not vote or do not participate in any way. Our job is to radically transform the Democratic Party. To transform the Democratic Party into a 50-state party and a party which does not continue to ignore half of the states in our country, including some of the poorest states in America. Our job is to create a Democratic Party, a grassroots party, where decisions are made from the bottom on up, not from the top on down. A party in which we open the doors and bring in the working people and young people of this country, black and white and Latino and Asian American and Native American, all Americans. But we will not succeed if we simply open up the doors. That's important, but it is not enough. The Democratic Party must make it clear to every working person in this country, whether they are currently Democrats, Republicans, or independents, that this party is prepared to take on the greed of the billionaire class. That we are prepared to take on the greed and recklessness of Wall Street. The greed of corporate America, the insurance industry, the drug companies. And the fossil fuel industry. The Democratic Party must make it clear, and make it clear that it is on the side of working families and the middle class, and we are prepared to create a government and an economy that works for all of us, not just the 1%. You know, life is not all that complicated. Every person here, every person in America wants to earn enough income and have enough money in the bank to be able to take care of their families, to have a secure retirement, to be able to leave something to your kids when you pass on. That is natural. That is what people want. But what is not natural, what is enormously destructive, is the kind of incredible greed that we see in the corporate culture of today. This is a greed which is undermining our economy and undermining our democracy. There are families in America today that have billions of dollars in wealth, who have assets that will enable their kids and grandchildren and great-grandchildren and on to live with a very high standard of living. Yet for some of these families, people worth billions, their greed has no end. They want more and more and more, and they are prepared to do anything to anybody to get it all. I will never forget, as a member of the Senate Budget Committee, I'll never forget a hearing that we held. We had representatives from the Business Roundtable, which is an organization made up of the CEOs from Wall Street and the largest corporations in America. And this guy who represented them, their lobbyist, came in and he said, well, we think you should cut Social Security and Medicare and Medicaid, and by the way, give large tax breaks to the wealthy and large corporations. Well, we did a little bit of research before that hearing, and it turns out, not surprisingly, that virtually every CEO in the Business Roundtable had millions of dollars put aside in their contracts so when they retire, they will get unbelievably large retirement benefits. So here you have people who are worth hundreds of millions of dollars, who have put into their contracts millions of dollars for their retirement, coming to the United States Congress and saying, cut the Social Security benefits of people making $13,000, $14,000 a year. So our message to the billionaire class and that incredible greed is, enough is enough. This country, our economy, our way of life belong to all of us and not just the handful on top. Brothers and sisters, we live today in the wealthiest country in the history of the world. We are not a poor country. But most people don't know that. They don't know that reality because almost all of the new wealth and income being created is going to the people on top. As the wealthiest nation on earth, we should not be the country which has more income and wealth inequality than any other major country. We should not be the country where the middle class for the last 40 years has been shrinking, where 43 million Americans live in poverty, while the people on top become richer and richer and richer. In America today, median household income, that family right in the middle of our economy, is today making almost $1,400 less than it was in 1999 after adjusting for inflation. Middle class is shrinking. People are working incredibly long hours to put enough income and health care to support their family. Meanwhile, the top 1/10 of 1%, not 1%, 1/10 of 1% owns almost as much wealth as the bottom 90%. This is not only an economic issue, brothers and sisters, this is a moral issue. This nation will not survive morally, it will not survive economically when so few have so much and so many have so little. We as a nation, people in Maine, the people in Vermont, people all across this country, have got to decide whether we think it is acceptable that the 20 wealthiest people in this country today own as much wealth as the bottom half of America. Or whether it is acceptable that one family, the Walton family of Walmart, now owns more wealth alone, one family, than the bottom 42% of the American people. The very rich are becoming phenomenally richer. In the last 17 years, since 2000, we have seen a tenfold increase in the number of billionaires in this country, and yet we have veterans sleeping out on the street and children in America going hungry. Not acceptable. But it is not just wealth inequality, it is income inequality as well. Today, mom is working, dad's working, the kids are working. But at the end of the day, 52% of all new income created today is going to the top 1%. That is what a rigged economy is about, and that is what together we are going to change. But we are confronting not only a rigged economy, we are confronting a corrupt political system. It is a system which, because of Citizens United, billionaires like the Koch brothers and others are able to spend hundreds of millions of dollars to elect candidates who represent the wealthy and the powerful. And let me tell you something that you may not know. The Republican leadership and the Koch brothers are not content with Citizens United that allows them to spend unlimited amounts of money in political campaigns. Not good enough for them. They want to do, the Republican leadership in Congress wants to eliminate all campaign finance limitations, which will mean that the Koch brothers will not just do independent expenditures, they will be able to give donations directly to the candidate. What that means, I want you to know what that means. It means somebody running for governor, senator here in Maine, they give him a check for $20 million and say, you know what? You work for me. There's your campaign manager. There's your media person. There is your speechwriter. You are an employee of mine. If we do not stand up and overturn Citizens United, demand a democracy of one person, one vote, but it's not only big money buying elections. You got cowardly Republican governors all over this country who are working overtime to suppress the vote, to make it harder for poor people or people of color or old people or young people to participate in our democracy. And I say to those cowardly Republican governors, if you don't have the guts to participate in free, open, and fair elections if you don't have the courage of your convictions. Get out of politics and get another job. The goal of the Republican Party and Donald Trump is very, very obvious. They want to get rid of virtually every major piece of legislation passed since the 1930s, which protect the interest of working people, children, seniors, and the sick. That is their goal. That is the script written for them by the Koch brothers and other billionaires. They want tax breaks for the very wealthiest people in this country, and then they want to chip away at Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid. They want to cut back education, and they want to destroy virtually every important piece of environmental regulation put in place over the last 40 years. They want massive increases in military spending, but they also want to eliminate after-school programs. They want, as you have heard, to end the Meals on Wheels program. Now, I know in Vermont, and I'm sure it's the same in Maine, you got a lot of senior citizens who have very little money. And Meals on Wheels provides them the one hot, nutritious meal they may get in a day. Can you imagine Republican leadership wanting to give tax breaks to billionaires and cut back on the Meals on Wheels program and after-school programs and nutrition programs for pregnant women? What kind of morals do these people have? And let me make it clear to Governor LePage and to right-wing governors across the country, and to President Trump and the Republican leadership in Congress, our vision for the future of this country is a very different vision than yours, and our vision, and I want everybody in this room tonight to know this, our vision is the vision of the American people. Poll after poll tells us you can go to the most conservative parts of America and you ask people what they think it makes sense to give tax breaks to billionaires and cut Social Security and Medicare and Meals on Wheels and after-school programs, and people will look you in the eye and say, are you crazy? That's not what America can be. Brothers and sisters, at a time when 28 million Americans today have no health insurance, and many more, including many in this room, are underinsured with high deductibles and high copayments, our job is not only to prevent the repeal of the Affordable Care Act, we have got to go further. It is not acceptable to me, it is not acceptable to you, that we remain the only major country on earth not to guarantee health care to all people as a right. And that is why I will soon be introducing legislation calling for a Medicare for All single-payer program. The insurance companies may not like it, and the drug companies may not like it, but it makes, that's not exactly the words I would use. Not bad. But it makes no sense that we end up spending twice as much per capita as our Canadian neighbors, three times more than many per capita, more than many of the countries in Europe, all of whom guarantee health care to all of their people. Makes no sense. The United States must join the industrialized world. Health care is a right, not a privilege. And by the way, when we talk about health care, we cannot forget the scandal of, again, our people being forced to pay by far the highest prices in the world for prescription drugs. Here is how crazy this situation is. One out of five Americans under 65, they go to the doctor because they're sick, they get a prescription, they can't even afford to fill that prescription because the prices are so high. Today, you can walk into a drugstore and the medicine you've been using for years, you'll find the price is double or triple. No laws to protect the American consumer. Well, we got news for the drug companies. And that is not acceptable that 2 years ago, the five major drug companies made $50 billion in profit. Meanwhile, senior citizens in Maine and Vermont are cutting their pills in half. We are going to take on the drug companies, lower the cost of prescription drugs in this country. At a time when so many of our people all over this country are working for starvation wages, the time is now to raise the minimum wage to a living wage, $15 an hour. It is not a radical idea to say that in Vermont or in Maine, if you work 40 hours a week, you should not be living in poverty. And here in Maine, we have got to stand together against all efforts to roll back the minimum wage legislation passed by the people of this state. And when we talk about wages, we must not continue being a nation in which women earn 79 cents on the dollar compared to men. I hear a lot of talk from my Republican colleagues about their belief in family values. But apparently it doesn't lead them to do anything to end the disgrace of the United States having the highest rate of childhood poverty of any major country on earth. Working mothers in Maine and Vermont cannot afford to pay $10,000 or $15,000 a year for childcare. We need universal childcare. We need to be investing in education in this country, not jails and incarceration. And by the way, in a competitive global economy, we need the best educated workforce in the world. We need to make public colleges and universities tuition free. And we also need to end the absurdity of millions of our people having to deal decade after decade with outrageous levels of student debt. We should not be punishing people for getting the best education they can. We should be rewarding them. In the United States of America, we should not be the only major nation on earth that does not guarantee paid family and medical leave. How absurd it is that poor countries all over the world know that when a mom has a baby, she has the right to stay home with that baby, love that baby. In this country, a woman can have a baby and be forced to go back to work in a week or two after birth because she lacks the income to stay home. That is wrong. That has got to change. We should not be a nation in which we have more people in jail than any other country on earth. Disproportionately African American, Latino, and Native American. We need to rethink the so-called war on drugs. We must not be a nation in which 11 million undocumented people are forced to live in the shadows and live in fear. We need not to harass and intimidate and frighten people. We need comprehensive immigration reform and a path toward citizenship. Now, you have already heard this evening about the absurdities of Trump's policies, but one of them is particularly embarrassing. And that is, while virtually every scientist in the world who studies the issue understands that climate change is real, that it is caused by human activity, that it is already causing devastating problems in our country and around the world, we have a president who thinks climate change is a hoax. President Trump, listen to the scientists and not the lobbyists from the fossil fuel industry. Throughout his campaign for president, Trump told the American people, he said, you know, I am a different type of Republican. I am not going to cut Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid. I am going to drain the swamp. I am going to take on Wall Street. And by the way, President Obama took too much vacation time. Not me! I'm going to be working 24/7. He told us that he was going to lower the cost of prescription drugs. He was going to completely change our disastrous trade policies. He was going to reinstate the Glass-Steagall Act of 1933, and he was going to raise the minimum wage to at least 10 bucks an hour. That is what he said during the campaign. Well, it turns out that he lied. It appears that he never had any intention of standing up for working families. And in fact, he is seeking to implement one of the most destructive budgets and policy directives in the history of our country, which, if successful, would wreak havoc on the lives of the working class and middle class of this country. President Trump, you are not protecting working people when you support a health care proposal which provides $300 billion in tax breaks for the top 2%, throws 24 million people off of health insurance, defunds Planned Parenthood, cuts Medicaid by $800 billion, and raises premiums for senior citizens to a very significant degree. You don't help working people when you appoint people to your administration who have devoted their entire political lives to figuring out how they could best cut Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid. You don't drain the swamp when you include more billionaires in your administration than any president in the history of our country. You don't help working families when their relatives are suffering with cancer and diabetes, and yet you slash funding for the National Institute of Health by $5.8 billion. Brothers and sisters, we are facing a pivotal moment in American history. There is no doubt in my mind that the progressive agenda, an agenda that works for working families and lower-income people and seniors, this is the agenda supported by the overwhelming majority of Americans. But in order to implement that agenda, we need your involvement and the involvement of millions of people throughout this country. In this room tonight, there are people who should be ready to run for city councils all over the state, for school boards all over the state, for state legislature all over the state, for Congress, for U.S. Senate, whatever. What I have learned in my political life is that when people stand together, when they show respect to each other, and understand that on issues we'll disagree on this or that issue, but when we stand together around a progressive agenda, which demands that in this nation we have a government and an economy that works for all of us, when we do that, there is nothing that we cannot do. So my plea to you tonight, and we're beginning to see all over this country, Republicans used to have their town meetings and 30 people would come out talking about how they got to cut Social Security and Medicare. Suddenly these guys are facing 1,000 people who say you're not going to take away health insurance. Millions of people came out for the Women's March. Hundreds of thousands of people are coming out for rallies all across this country. We are the majority of the American people. The American people do not want billionaires to get tax breaks. They don't want to see our environment destroyed. They don't want to see nutrition programs cut for hungry kids. We are the majority. It is time we flexed our muscles. It is time we got involved in a way we have never done before. It is time to make the political revolution. Thank you all.
Revolution to make a solution.